So hi, my name is Teresa. I'm a PhD candidate at St. Louis University. And today I'm going to be talking about one of my research projects focused on quantifying microplastic debris sourcing and transport for a karst aquifer. And this project was partially funded by the National Cave and Karst Research Institute and the Cave Research Foundation. So as most of us here already probably know, microplastics are these very tiny little pieces of plastic that exist in the environment. And the reason why they're concerning is because they can be transported really easily through the environment, and they can be dangerous to our life due to ingestion and physical damage, or due to other contaminants and toxins being transported on their surface. So historically, microplastic research has been focused on marine environments. And here we see on the left, two figures of two research projects focused on plastic contamination in the open ocean, as well as shorelines across the world. And more recently, there has been more and more research focused on quantifying microplastics in surface freshwater environments, such as rivers and lakes. However, what about microplastics in groundwater? So in 2019, there was a report that suggested the potential of microplastics to contaminate groundwater. And here I'm showing two of those pathways on the left, either by losing stream, where surface water percolates through soils and rocks and eventually reaches the groundwater, or through injection wells, where water that's been used on the surface is re-injected in the subsurface and potentially bringing plastics to the groundwater. However, so far, only one study has quantified plastic with physical groundwater samples. This study was by Pano et al. In 2019. And what they found was a positive correlation of between microplastics and other contaminants, such as phosphates, which suggested a common source between microplastics and other contaminants. In this case, it was septic tanks. As I mentioned, this one study was focused on karst groundwater, which is also the type of landscape that I'm going to be looking at. So I'm very briefly going to talk about karst. So karst landscapes are this type of landscape characterized by the presence of dissolution features in the subsurface, such as caves and conduits, as we see on the diagram. And on the surface, we can see things like sinkholes, limestone pavements, sinking streams, and springs, like the picture, which are basically the surface expression of groundwater. And this very unique underground architecture of karst systems leads to very complex dual flow paths, where we see water being transported really fast through conduits and water being transported slowly through the rock matrix. And these dual flow paths makes karst systems very susceptible to surface contamination. So on the diagram on the left, I'm showing an example of a karst system being contaminated by road salts, where we see the sinkhole on those conduits basically acting like pipes, as well as slow contamination through the soils and the rock. So understanding contaminant fate and transport in karst systems is very important, especially in cave systems, because they very often host very fragile ecosystems with species such as the Ozark cavefish and the Grotto sculpin here in Missouri. So we have to very closely investigate contaminants to understand how those contaminants can affect those ecosystems. And here's where my study comes in, where I'm trying to quantify microplastic debris sourcing and transport for a karst aquifer. So moving on to my study site is Cliff Cave, which is the second longest cave in St. Louis County. It's located south of the St. Louis metropolitan area, right next to the Mississippi River, as you can see on the map. So all the water that flows out of the cave flows directly into the Mississippi River. And previous studies have estimated that there's about 39 sinkholes per square kilometer in this recharge area. This cave has a very beautiful large entrance, as you can see on the picture. And if we look at a digital elevation model, we can actually see the sinkholes. So here we're looking at the cave outline. So it's like a map view. And all these darker spots are the sinkholes that exist in the plain. And if we look at satellite imagery, we can see that most of the cave is located underneath a forested area, but part of the cave is located under a neighborhood, kind of emphasizing the potential of urban contamination entering the cave. And the last characteristic I want to mention about the cave is that it has a very flashy response to rainfall. And what that means is that recharge from rain occurs really fast in the system, and the water discharge goes up really fast and down really fast. And here, whenever there's a rainfall event. And here I'm showing two images, one from a base flow conditions at the top, and then one from a flood response where we see that the water is much more turbid and it's higher in stage. So to understand plastic transport and sources in the cave system, I conducted water quality, water sampling weekly over a whole year from February 2020 to February 2021. And I also conducted high frequency sampling during four flood events and from September through December 2020. And in addition to physical water samples, which were analyzed for plastic content as well as other chemical tracers, I also conducted water quality monitoring of different water quality parameters as well as stage monitoring, which was then converted to discharge. So moving on to the results, for my weekly samples, so far I've counted 12 of those samples, and I can say that I found plastic in every single one of them, from very low flow to relatively high flow. Concentrations of the plastic have ranged from 3.1 to 49 counts per liter. And if you look at the pie charts, you can see that most of the plastics were fibers and most of them are clear. And here I'm showing some pictures from the plastics that I found. Now, to understand how those plastics are being transported in the cave, I wanted to see how plastic concentration relates to other parameters in the water. And what I'm showing here at the bottom is the correlation, positive correlation that exists between plastic and suspended sediments, as well as the negative correlation that exists between plastic and specific conductance and pH. And what these plots are telling us basically is that we're seeing more plastic whenever there's more sediment, and whenever water is more dilute and slightly more acidic. And those conditions are met when we have a recharge event from rain, meaning that whenever rain is coming into the cave, we're also seeing more plastic. So the next step was trying to understand how plastic is transported during this high flow recharge events. And that is why I sampled at high frequency during four flood events. And we're gonna look at one in particular from October 2020. So if we look at the plots, the smaller plots on the right, I'm showing the typical flood hydrograph where we see an increase in discharge in gray in response to a precipitation event in black. And the plot at the bottom is just showing the turbidity response to this event, where we see a peak in turbidity the same time as the peak of discharge. Now, if we look at the other plot with the red dots, I'm showing discharge at the cave as well as plastic concentration. And it was very interesting to see this dual individual peaks in plastic during the flood. The first peak happens during the main discharge event. And then we saw a secondary peak in plastic whenever discharge was already low and turbidity was already low. So this was a little surprising. So we wanted to understand why the secondary peak was happening. And here, if we look at the plot on the left, we see discharge, turbidity in black, and then plastic again. And if we look at turbidity, we see a tiny little bump in turbidity that happens at the same time as that plastic peak. And we related that to two different types of turbidity that previous studies have talked about in the past. So this study by Pronk et al. Talks about how in karst system during flood events, we see an initial peak in turbidity that happens with the main peak in discharge that corresponds to orthogonous turbidity, meaning that it's turbidity that it comes from within the cave, inside the cave. And then we see a second peak in turbidity that happens with a peak in organic carbon that comes from the outside of the cave, from surface recharge. So the hypothesis we're currently working on is that these two peaks in plastic could also be potentially coming from two sources, one from the cave and one from outside the cave. So we're still working on this results. And what I do want to mention, though, is that this trend of two peaks in plastic in the cave is not unique to this flood in October. We've seen similar things for floods in September and November, as you can see in those plots at the top. And we have also seen for some of our weekly samples that we were finding very high plastic concentrations towards the end of a flood event, as you can see on the plots at the bottom. So the last little thing I wanted to mention today is the potential of, one of the things we're trying to figure out is where the plastic is coming from the recharge area in the cave. And one thing we noticed is that during our sampling, flood sampling, towards the end of one of our floods, the water was kind of blue, as you can see on the picture on the left. We see a typical turbid water sample, and then the other one is kind of blue. And I was actually able to find a very blue, artificially dyed pond within the recharge area of the cave. And you can see the location of the pond in the map relative to the cave entrance. And what we're working on trying to see if we can figure out if this water coming from the pond could be leaking into the karst and potentially also bringing plastics from this surface feature, artificial surface feature, to the karst. So just as a recap, in conclusion, microplastics are found in this cave during all flow regimes, from very high flow to very low flow. The majority of plastics are fibers, and most of them are clear. And microplastic transport in the cave is enhanced during and after rainfall events, which can have consequences for mitigation strategies, especially for that secondary peak whenever maybe plastic transport is less expected. And finally, microplastics are likely coming from two sources. In the case, we're working on a source coming from within the cave and a source coming directly from the surface during recharge events, but further analysis is needed. And with that, I will take questions. Thank you.
Yes, we do have time for questions. Lee?
Yep, there's a couple of questions. Very nice presentation, Teresa. Which method did you use to determine if the fibers you found were indeed plastic?
Yeah, so when I look at the filters through my microscope, I use a needle to kind of poke them and see if they are malleable. And whenever visual inspection is not enough, I use a hot needle test where I heat up my tweezers and I see if the fiber melts.
We have time for one more?
Yes.
Okay. Do you have a thought on what is the source for the clear microfibers? Cigarette filters, perhaps?
Yeah, so I still haven't had the chance to kind of think about what characteristics and color of the plastic means in this case. So unfortunately, I don't have an answer for that question. But as I mentioned, this is an ongoing study, and I'm still working on figuring those type of details out. So it will come in the future.